somebody that has truly, they've already made the decision. Jesus is it. Nothing else is going to be there. You see what I mean? In other words, that's kind of an interesting deal because, people who are wishy-washy, kind of half in, kind of half out, they can never truly be a leader. I mean, you give them a title and you put them in charge. But to truly be a leader is someone that has just really something, it's not here, it's something inside of them. It's not in their head, it's in their heart. Something has happened toward the Lord, and there's no looking back. You know, they crossed the bridge and they burned it down. You know. And like when Jesus was preaching and a bunch of people left him, and Jesus turned to the disciples and said, "Will you go away also?" And Peter goes, "Where will we go? You have the words of eternal life." And the person has made that commitment in their heart to Jesus. You have the words of eternal life. Where will I go? What possible options do I have? I have no options. I don't want any options. I've burned all my options. And so a true leader is one that leads by life, by example, by just being overridden by life of Christ or the love for the Lord, that they lead. And they're not always aware that they're leading. They're not always aware that they're leading. And I think that's important. I think that's important. People look at you and are affected and you don't know about them. Hopefully they're affected positively for the Lord. But people do look at you and they're affected, some people say, well, this person is exactly what I want. They are not sold out, but they're not carnal in the sense of just sloppy, sinners. They're exactly what I idolize. I thank God that there's somebody in this group that I can model my life after. Because if everybody were totally committed to Jesus, I would feel bad. So people, if that's you, then people look at you. People are glad to see you. But if on the other hand, there's something real in you, notice I say that because I believe there's a lot of religious people. They're just religious, it's religion. They're going after religion. But if you're real and you have a real love for the Lord and a real desire for the Lord, then other people look at your life and you're influencing all kind of people. All kind of people. And people will see things that you won't be aware of because you're not aware of. It's the way you become. It's the way you think. You know what I mean? I mean, they're seeing stuff out of you and you're just, after a while it's, following the Lord and taking up the cross and denying yourself and things like that are more or less second nature. They're like your heart beating. You don't have to beat your heart. I better keep this up. No, you don't have to worry about breathing. You breathe. It becomes like that. It becomes who you are. And therefore, a lot of what people are struggling with, they're saying, how do you do that? And all this kind of stuff. You're going, well, how do you not do that? I can't imagine life without the Lord in this way. It's just, and you're not trying to be super spiritual. You're not trying to, You're not trying to come up with some deal to pawn off on people. You truly, when you look in the depths of yourself, you cannot imagine life any other way. Nor do you want it to be any other way. Jesus is all. And then on. Now see, those are scriptures until they become everything we hold to be is true. You know what I'm saying? Everything we hold to be is true. This is me. This is not just what I believe. Because what you truly believe is what you are. If you're eating, you know, if you're believing things, you know, you take facts, and, you know, here are the 10 facts I believe, and you stick it in your head, you know, okay, now this is what I believe, you know. What was it? Okay, let's say number 9 is this, you know. But if it's in your heart, if you're eating that, and that's why the Lord told, remember the prophet Ezekiel? Write all this stuff down, and he said, now eat it. Anybody remember that? I mean, now eat it. You know? So you eat that. And it assimilates into you. And so that's the difference between learning and being. Between going to a Bible school and spending 3 years learning Bible stuff. I went to a Bible school and learned Bible stuff. Man, there are too many Bible schools out there that you can go to learn Bible stuff. That's not the purpose of this one. This one is to eat the Word of God and let it become who you are. When people look, they have a hard time, in certain things, they have a hard time seeing the difference between you and Jesus. The problem a lot of times is that they don't know Jesus that well, and so they see you, and they think what is Jesus in you is actually you. And you're going, that ain't me. That's Jesus. If you knew me, if you knew the real me, the way I was before, you would know that this isn't the way I am. You would know that this is Jesus. But they, how can they know? I mean, number one, they didn't know you before. Number two, they have not seen Jesus in this manner yet. And so, a lot of what's Jesus gets reduced down to what's somebody. Well, Randy, that's just your personality. You're just a committed sort of guy, you know, which really makes me laugh, because before I came to the Lord, man, I mean, I was a hippie, you know. Basically, what you're committed to is your own comfort, drugs, sex, and rock and roll. I mean, you know, I mean, that's your life, and you think that that's, you know, a pretty good life. And man, I was always late for work and everything else, and I had no desire to work or do anything really. I mean, you know, just to kick back. And basically what I wanted to do was live in a treehouse with a horse underneath it. Oh, wait a minute, that wasn't me, that was somebody else. I can't remember who that was. Oh, that was Ben. Oh, I knew I got that story from somewhere. No, but I mean, it's that sort of deal. I mean, there's something in there that kicks in, and you say, well, you know, this is me, and that is you. It's like, you know, and this isn't the same, so we're leaving that subject now. But it's like a pig that you wash up and you spray with, you know, nice sweet perfume, and you put a little bow on it, and you say, look, I've got the sweetest pig in the world, and you let him go, and he'll head straight for a mud puddle. You know? Well, that's what we are, folks. Unless, and that's the glorious story of this whole thing with Christ as your life, is that all that you are, all the failures, all of the mess, all of the natural inclinations are overcome by supernatural life. Now, I'm going to tell you something right now. This is just me talking about it. It's in your class. If I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be up here, and I certainly wouldn't be talking and saying this stuff, and this place wouldn't be here. If I didn't believe that with all my heart, that the natural inclinations can be overcome by a supernatural life of Christ, then this place wouldn't even exist, and that is the truth. You know, Christ in you, the hope. Christ in you, the hope. What is your hope? You have no hope unless you have Christ in you. Not just Christ your Savior, not just Christ the one who's going to come and redeem you from something apart from yourself. You know. And basically, I mean, you know, you see bumper sticker, you know, on somebody's car, Jesus saves, you know, they drive like, you know, a maniac, they hang their head out the window, oh, you're an idiot, or, you know, all this kind of stuff, and, you know. What they need is a bumper sticker that says, Christ saves from yourself. You know, and they need to live that. But that's the problem. Jesus saves, but all we believe is he saved me from something that's going to come at me out here. The devil, the world, bad circumstances, eventually hell. All of these things that are coming at me. And great truth of Christ and Him crucified, the great truth of the cross is He saves you from you so that He can come forth, so that He might fill all things. that he might fill all things. And this is where, I mean, you go through the scriptures and you begin to see this principle over and over and over. You are an earthen vessel. He's the treasure that fills you. You are a branch. He is the vine that fills the branch. Over and over and over. Almost all the examples relate to him filling you up, not him. When I say filling you up, I mean as a cup or as a branch. I don't mean like most people think of, I'm just filled with Jesus. No, 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 no. You're filled with you and you got him. You've got his feelings on you right now. You know, I'm talking about you out, not I, Christ liveth. What? What's the rest of it? In me. Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. Not just Christ. Oh, Christ, you know, they have that saying, and I use it a lot in Mexico. You know, quien vive? You know, who lives? And of course they say, Cristo! And boy, it's big. It's everywhere. Everywhere in Mexico. Who lives, you know? And they're all going, yeah, he's alive, he lives, you know? And they love to shout that, don't they? And then I always come back with, donde? And after my conference, they all shout, in me! Quien vive Cristo, donde? In me! Their whole view changes. And isn't that the purpose of this ministry? To bring a change to people's view, not just to a Jesus far away, not to a Jesus someday, not to a helper Jesus, an assistant Jesus, Jesus my assistant, Jesus my co-pilot. Oh my God, you know, you're going to kill him. You know? Either better let him drive or let him ride with me, because you're going to kill him. You know? Because this is not, I mean, Jesus didn't come to take sides. He came to take over. And when he does, boy, he truly does. I mean, if you let him in the manner in which we're talking about, he doesn't take over from a position of the throne as king and I'll just take over everything like some sort of a tyrant. That's just the opposite of the Spirit. But he takes over as we deny ourselves, as we take up the cross, as we begin to follow him. Not follow our own inclinations. Follow him. Follow him. And there comes eventually a joy to that. I mean, when I say eventually, in many cases it should be right off the bat. And sometimes we do, you know. How many of you know this? We love ourselves. We do. We love ourselves. Everybody does. God doesn't convince your sinful nature to stop loving himself. He crucifies. Amen? Because you cannot convince that. You know, that's like somebody with demons and you're trying to talk them into, you know, to not, you know, being mean and you don't try to kill that person and you know, and the demons are going, yeah, right. You know, I mean, you know, the demons aren't going to go, well, that's right. You know, I mean, killing's not good at all. No. God, killing wouldn't be good. Demon isn't going to do that. He's going to go, what are you talking about? I can't even understand your language. You know, I will do what I must do. You know, I am evil. I am the God of hellfire. You begin to realize what you're up against, not just with demons, but the old nature. He's not going to change. God didn't come to change the old nature. God didn't come to convince the old nature. And you'll never talk the old nature into laying down its life. Huh? Remember? God said to Adam. God said to Adam. Now, if you eat, you're going to die. In the day that you eat, you should surely die. So what did he do? Him and Eve went, they ate the fruit. And he goes, oh my God, I ate. Let's see, what's the next step here? Hide! You know, he didn't come walking up to God and go, well, I blew it. I ate. I deserve to die. Kill me. You know, put me into death. He's never going to do that. He's going to run and hide, and when God hunts him down, he's going to say, she did it! Okay? And she's going to say, the snake did it! And the snake's going to go, I don't have any arms. You cursed me. Well, you know, God did that to the serpent. He took it took away his feet. He defeated him. Anyway, that's just so you know that. And that's it. I mean, that's Adam. That's exactly what Adam will do, is that he's going to, you know, and your nature, your Adamic nature, your Adam nature within you, when somebody puts their finger on that, is going to first, before the finger comes, it's going to go try to hide. Okay? And you can hate yourself and just go, oh my God, I can't believe I act this way. Well, Adam will always act that way. Your Adamic nature, your fallen nature will always act that way. And then when the finger finally gets pointed at you, you're going to go, well, it was somebody else. I mean, it's just fallen human nature. All right? So, God's plan isn't to deal with you. He didn't come to deal with the fallen creation. He didn't come to convince it. He didn't come to spend hours talking to it. He didn't come to give speeches and rhetoric that is just, you know, overwhelmingly convincing. And you know, have silver-tongued orators stand in front of the church and speak this stuff, and everybody goes, oh, man, dude! No. It is the foolishness of preaching the cross. It is the foolishness that begins to, the cross begins to strike deep, and then a realization begins to come in that person, not, I need to die, but I'm dead. I am crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. I'm not going to convince my flesh. I'm not going to crucify my flesh. I'm not going to present myself to God and die. And in fact, and here's the key, who I am is not all this that I see coming out of me. That's dead. Isn't that good? You say, but how do I know that? I mean, this is what I've lived with all my life. This is who I thought I was. This is the me that I know. Well, let me introduce you to the you that Jesus knows. And that introduction will not turn your face to peer, but will look inside of him, and there you find out who you are, what you are, how to act, how to think, how to be. It's a new creation, folks. It's a whole new species. One of the translations translates it that way. If any person is in Christ, he's a new species. Okay? And this species talks differently. It thinks differently. We were just talking about this. Patty and Carolyn and I were talking about, even among, if you will, one species, Costa Ricans and Mexicans. And then they were having to redo some of the things that were translated in Costa Rica because of the way that they presented things. And that many of the Mexicans wouldn't understand certain things, certain ways of saying stuff and what it's all about. It's a whole different deal. Well, if that is within interspecies, how much more with being a whole new species? But it's not just learning a new vocabulary. It is learning a whole new way of viewing yourself and viewing the Lord. It's not just viewing the Lord and put this out. Not just viewing the Lord as up here and I'm down here and I'm always needing to pray, fast, read my Bible, all of these things becoming steps to get to this God. It is a whole nother picture that you are found in Christ, but you're hid there. You're not seen there in the sense of you. You are hid, and being hid there, Christ is your life. He is your identity. And I'll just say this, the knowledge that transforms is not preaching knowledge. It is not Bible school knowledge. It is image-changing knowledge. And no other knowledge will do it. So that means that you can learn all the books of the Bible and not change your image. You can learn to quote all the books of the Bible by memory, and that not be image-changing knowledge. But you can begin to see the truth. And when I say the truth, I mean the truth. The truth, not truths of prayer, going to church, Bible reading, this sort of stuff, da da da. All these things and all of this added up to a 3-year education or whatever, you know. But, because that's just truths. But you begin to see the truth as it is in Jesus. Not just truth. The truth as it is in Jesus, the scriptures say in Ephesians. The truth, because it's true that, you know, it's true that if you plant a seed, it'll grow out there. It's true that, and all of those can be truths all by themselves, and never, and somebody not even understand the fallen, done, and died on the cross and all that. You understand what I'm saying? It's just truths. It's all truths. None of those truths change you. The only truth that will change you is the truth. And that truth is truth that brings an identity change. Until you are changed into His image, until your identity is no longer you for Jesus, you after Jesus. I read when I was in Costa Rica, at one juncture, we were doing a conference at one side of the country, and we did it that day. And then that night, Jeff and I went back, and we left Doug and Simon to finish that conference. We went back for the next morning to be able to have another conference going on at the same time in Costa Rica. And got home, and I had a little bit of time, and I was back in his kind of little guest room, and he's got all of his books back there, and pulled off one of his books by a man named Fenelon. Anybody ever heard of Fenelon? And real good stuff. And he apparently was higher up in the Catholic Church and apparently knew the Lord to some degree. And this younger person writes him and says, I'm just really pursuing the Lord, and I am really trying to go further, and I'm really, you know, after God and everything. And I wish I could just read the thing to you, because it's going to be better than anything I could tell you. But his response to him was, instead of you trying to get something, be something, find something, attain to something, just be hid. Just be hid.